Welcome back. We're learning Tanya, chapter 48, Likutei Amorim, for Sunday, the 16th of Iyar. Yesterday we counted 31.
Right.
So, know what to count today.
Right.
The flow. Besides a ray of the divine light, which is contracted in order to create the world, referred to as Memale Kol Amin, there is a greater revelation of God which is not limited in any way, and therefore cannot be enclosed in the world, which is an interesting statement. First, we just said, there's a greater revelation of God which is not limited, and then right away we say, cannot be enclosed in the world. Not limited and cannot be enclosed. The fact that it cannot be enclosed in the world, it's not because it, because the world. Understand? So if the light is not limited, then it's not limited to anything. It's not limited also to limitation.
Right.
The reason why it's not coming into limitation, because the limitation would be harmed by it.
You wouldn't have any limitation. You wouldn't have not. It would be mevatel.
Right. So.
So he has it in the Simpson.
But no. But there is this, the unlimited light is not being contracted.
It's not being contracted. Then what's the Simpson?
Simpson is contracting the mamala light.
The
Seviv light is not being contracted. That's what, listen to this, it says, beside a ray, focus, beside a ray of the divine light which is contracted in order to create the world. So you have light that's being contracted to create the world.
Right.
Referred to as Memale Kol Amin, it's filling the world, that's what's called Memale, it fills the world. But yet there is a greater revelation of God which is not limited in any way. But then he goes to say, and therefore cannot be enclosed in the world. It's not limited, but cannot be enclosed. I'm saying these two things are a contradiction. It's a paradoxy in a way to say, or oxymoron. If you say it's not limited, then it can do whatever it wants. But then you tell me it cannot be enclosed in the world, meaning that there is some kind of limitation, that it's not cannot be enclosed in the world.
Right.
So what is the answer? The answer that comes to my mind is that it can be enclosed in the world, but the world cannot handle it, therefore it's not going into the world. It's not that from the Seviv's perspective, from the encompassing light perspective, from the non-limited light perspective, it can be enclosed in the world. But the world is not going to be a world. Like you said, the world will be nullified.
Right.
So he writes, and only affects the world in an encompassing way. So it affects the world in such a way that the world is not going to be harmed by it and benefit from it. How it benefits, we have to see. But it comes, it affects the world, it's not being enclosed in the world, but it gives the world an indirect way, encompassing way. An illustration of the Seviv of the circular energy being present, yet in an abstract way, is man's mind. Wrapping itself around an object or scene, the item is both enveloped by the brain, yet not at all. Right? You're looking at a picture. Your mind is picturing, seeing it. But nothing happens to the picture, the fact that your mind is enveloped with this picture. Picture itself is not touched.
Right.
Your mind has all the details of the picture. It's enveloped in your mind. Still the picture itself remains the same thing. Why? Because you enveloping the picture is only external. It's not internal. It's not in you. It's from the outside. The Seviv is affecting the world from the outside, from the exterior, externally.
So you could think about the picture and the composition of the picture, and I learned about lines and parallel, and
Yeah. Over here, he uses the example of circular energy being present, an illustration of the save of circular energy being present, yet in an abstract way, is man's mind wrapping itself around an object or scene. The item is both enveloped by the brain, yet not at all. It's enveloped in the brain, but yet nothing, there's nothing there. Can you say that anything happens to the object if you're thinking about the object? The object itself. The fact that you know all the details about the object, does it change anything about the object? No. To illustrate this point, consider the this material world, even though the whole world is full of his glory. Namely, not only with a minute glimmer of godliness, but with infinite light of the blessed Ein Sof, as it is written, do I not fill heaven and earth? Says Hashem, Af al pichein ein mislavish b'seichu es gilu hashpo chayus mi'at mize'eir b'chinos deimim tzimeach levad. Nevertheless, only very limited vitality of no more than the category of what is revealed in the inanimate and vegetable worlds is closed within these worlds in the form of revealed influence. While all the light of the blessed Ein Sof, which fills the world itself in a concealed manner, is described as encompassing it, even though it actually pervades it. Since its influence is no more revealed in it, then it is revealed within the inanimate and vegetable worlds, but affects it in a hidden and concealed manner. Any kind of flow that comes from above and it's hidden is called makif, encompassing from above. Encircling from above. Any influence of concealed nature is referred to as encircling from above. The concealed world is higher, is on a higher rung than the revealed world. Godliness drawn down in a concealed manner from the hidden world is on a higher plane than that which is drawn down in a revealed manner from the revealed world, emanating as it does from the from a higher level. This mode of divine influence is said to be encircling from above. Let us make this more intelligible by means of an example. Further example is indeed in order to clarify this paradox. How godliness simultaneously pervades the world and yet remains aloof from it. If you're pervading the world, then you are supposed to be visible. How is it possible that you're pervading the world and at the same time being invisible? Remains aloof from it, encircling and encompassing it as it were from above and not being revealed within it. When a person forms an image in his mind of something that he has seen or sees, in av shekol guf etzem adover ha'uve gabi v'sircho v'sirtecha kulo mitzuyo b'dayto machshavtem pen shiro'u chuloi o shiro'ehu, even though the entire body and essence of that thing, both its exterior and interior and its very core, are completely mirrored in his mind and thought, for he has seen it or is seeing it in its entirety. This is expressed by saying that his mind encompasses that object completely. And just as in the mind's frame of reference, so too regarding the perspective of the visualized object. And that thing is enveloped by his mind and thought. It is encompassed in actual fact only in the imagination of the man's thought and mind. Since man's thought is limited, he cannot actually encompass the object itself. He only encompasses its image as it exists within his mind.
So it's an illusion.
God, however, of whom it is written, "For my thoughts are not your thought," so that it is utterly impossible for us to grasp his thought process. His thought and his mind, which knows all created beings, encompasses each and every created thing, from its head, from its highest level, to its end, to its lowest level, and its inside and very core, all in actual reality, and not as with the thought of a mortal man. So the takeaway from today's essay, chapter 48, says, imagine a beautiful castle. Imagine the infrastructure, imagine the design. All this exists within your imagination. Your imagination encompasses each detail of the image, and this imaginary castle will cease when you stop thinking about it. Right? It's only there while you think about it. Similar to this is God's energy, which encompasses the world, with one difference. It is real with God. He does encompass and energize a real world. Ruchim Tiyu, we're going to learn shortly daily Parsha insight. It can be found on page Chayenu, page 173. So I'll make another video for that one. See you soon.